on September 11th, 2001, I worked 64th floor for Morgan Stanley. You know, the day started like any other. When I left my house, I left usually around 6 o'clock in the morning to catch the train. I lived in Neptune, New Jersey at the time. And I was married. Was I married? Yeah, I was married. And I did my normal goodbye ritual because my husband was, he worked a little later than I did. I took the train, and it was funny because I slept on the way up there, but I always woke up at a certain point, and I ended up texting my boss right before we were pulling into Newark, and I said, God, is this really what it's all supposed to be about? Like, with us commuting 5 hours a day, all this stuff. And so we kind of had that little conversation, but I got into the city. I went up to my office. My office was an outside office. In other words, it had a window facing, I was not facing the North Tower. I was like a corner away from that. And I kind of, again, going with rituals, went in, I put my bag down, I changed my shoes because, you know, we always wore sneakers into the city. And I put my food away. And as I was, it's interesting the things, by the way, that stick out in your mind, because one of the things right then and there was I looked out at the sky and I was like, oh my God, those are like Simpsons clouds, you know, from the show, The Simpsons at the beginning, the intro. They were just very surreal for some reason, very cartoonish. And I was getting ready for a meeting that I was going to have at 8:30. And there was this huge boom, you know, the building just kind of shook. And I was just a little startled, like, that was odd. And then I hear somebody go in the corner office, around the corner from me, go, what the hell was that? And I go running into the conference room and I look up at the North Tower, which was, of course, the first to be hit. And it was like a ticker tape parade. It's such a weird thing too. Associate such tragedy with something we normally associate with such joy, right? Which, by the way, I think is a huge part of the day. Sorry, getting my tissues. Because your mind tricks you. So I just thought, God, I mean, I literally remember a roll of toilet paper flying out of the air and unraveling on the way down. So we all just kind of stood there like, the hell? And, you know, all of a sudden somebody started yelling, get the hell out, get the hell out. So we went to the exit. And the guy who was yelling that had actually been there for the 93 bombing? So he kind of knew, like, he knew what the role was, or what the drill was. When we got to the door, we couldn't get it open, which was fine. Apparently it just took some, you know, manhandling, I guess. So we got in the hall in the stairwell, and you'll hear this a lot, by the way, that we were just walking down very casually. Like, we knew we had a long way to go. We were like, oh my God, we got to walk down 64 flights of stairs. And nobody was, it was hot, but you know, nobody was in any kind of rush. And occasionally you saw people stopped because they were like, they needed a rest. And I can only recall one person on the way down who flipped out and was running down and pushing through everybody. And we were all just getting very angry at him for his sense of panic. I have no idea who it was. But we still just kept going down. And when I hit the 30th floor, there was an announcement that a plane had hit the first building. They wanted us to evacuate. But if we felt more comfortable staying in the building, it was fine. And it was funny because at that point I thought to myself, God, that's a really, like, it didn't seem like a very professional announcement. It just seemed like somebody had picked it up and started telling us what to do. And so we did, we just kind of kept walking. And by the time 10 floors later, I was getting around the 20th floor, our building was hit. And by the way, I should add that when they said that the first building had been hit by a plane, I mean, again, my mind is creating all sorts of things that just made sense and were a lot more pleasant than what was actually going on. So, so in my mind, the first plane hitting the building was like a tour plane or something that was just, you know, just happened. It was a terrible tragedy. So the building hits now, or the plane now hits our building. Very odd sensation. And in fact, interesting, because the other day my town, or, you know, Monmouth County just had an earthquake in the middle of the night. And it's very similar in feeling. It was a very odd sound. It was a very odd sensation. You know, we all kind of fell to the wall a little bit, like, what the hell? I mean, and as I understand that, I don't know if this is true or not, that the building was meant to stabilize. In fact, somebody was yelling that in the hall. So, you know, that the building is meant to take that kind of, not that kind of impact, but to take an impact and kind of shake itself out and rebalance. I don't know if that's true. That's just what I remember hearing. But it was scary, but still nobody was panicking. It was odd because we still didn't know what was going on. And so again, my mind creates this story that either the other building had exploded from the impact of the first plane, or, you know, this was just the effect of what was going on. So we kept walking, and I can't remember what floor we were on when we finally saw the light of day. But it was a lobby floor, and it was a lobby floor I had never been on before. I don't think I was on. It's weird trying to remember this stuff 20 years later, because some of it is very clear, and some of it, through all the stories you've heard over the years, it's kind of like you kind of have trouble, like, was this my experience or was this what other people were experiencing? It gets a little shady after 20 years. But when one of the things that stuck out to me, and again, just weird things that I remember, was there was a hole. There was a huge picture window. And I mean, by picture window, I mean, a huge 20 feet, 10 feet. I have no idea. I have no perspective on it. But there was a huge, like, what looked like a cannonball shaped hole toward the bottom of the window. And I was like, well, that's odd. You know, just, I couldn't make sense of it. And my mind was trying to, and there was nothing there. And I'm like, okay. And I looked out on the plaza, and there is nothing but debris. Like ankle deep in my mind. Again, you know, it's hard to say what perception versus reality was. But in my mind, there was ankle deep debris out there. And so confusing. And then we proceeded down an escalator to where I was familiar with entering the building, down where the shops were. And I walked out there. There was somebody, there was a gentleman standing out there who was visibly distraught. And I don't know if he had a disability or if he was just panicked. And at this point, by the way, I should say, on my way down the stairs, I was with my department. Everybody I knew was there. I don't know where they ended up being, but I lost them somewhere along the way. So by the time I got down to the shops, I was by myself. Like nobody was there. Not even my department. I just didn't see anybody. I don't remember seeing anybody except this gentleman. I asked him if he needed help, and he said no. So I kept walking, and there was this very, I always talk about this very weird cup of coffee that had been spilled on the floor that to this day, I always picture it. And I go, God, that's weird. That coffee is just spilled in the wrong direction. I don't know what that means. It just was spilled oddly to me. And I know this all seems like insignificant stuff, but I think these are the things that your mind allows you to glom onto to not, you know, see the tragedy. So anyway, I finally got out of the building, and they ushered us around what I think was the plaza. At this point, it was very disorienting. And there was this girl out there screaming on her cell phone, oh my God, a plane hit the building. She was using a lot more expletives than that. And I turned around because I still don't know what's going on. I turned around and I actually said, shut the F up. Like, what did she know? But, you know, what I didn't know was what they knew. you know, they had seen it. So eventually, somehow along the way, I did run into other people, not from my department, but from my floor. And we kind of banded together as this little troop. And everybody played a role. Like it was kind of neat to show how teamwork and leadership works, in the sense that when we were in this part of town, one woman took over and said, listen, I know that our agency is up on this street over here. Let's go to our ad agency. Let's get us safely away. So we did. I mean, we went to this agency. I didn't know who these people were, but I still don't know the names of them. They totally took us in. And it seemed that other people had that idea also, because it didn't seem like everybody belonged there. There was a lot of confusion, understandably. There was one window from that office where they could see the World Trade Center. And while we were trying to gather ourselves, people started screaming, oh my God, the building fell. So that would be South Tower, I think, was the one that fell first. And I ran over to the window, and again, I saw the building. I'm like, it's in the vault right there, you know? And then meanwhile, now we're trying to make phone calls, right? I had a pager, or a two-way pager at the time. I guess it was BlackBerry. And so I was eventually able to reach my husband. Because I was like, oh my gosh, he doesn't even know this is going on. He's still sleeping. But of course, all the neighbors had kind of like descended on our house to help him. But now I'm trying to find my family. Now, the interesting part about my family's story and all this is that my sister also worked for Morgan Stanley, and she worked seven or eight floors above me, and she was pregnant. But they were on their anniversary vacation in Canada. So, you know, I attribute that to saving my life. I would not have left the area if she was there. But I knew she wasn't, so that was cool. And then my parents were actually flying home from Germany that day and ended up getting grounded in Canada. So there was really no way to really reach anybody. I think I finally ended up calling my grandfather and left him this crazy voicemail to say I was okay. And then the second building fell. And again, I ran over to the window, but in my mind, those buildings were there. You know, when were they not? And we eventually ended up kind of saying, all right, we need to get something to eat, because we knew we had a long day ahead of us. And we ended up finally saying, we got to start trying to find a way home. So again, my little group headed out, and now it was like somebody else knew this other part of town. So we were going to head there to go to the Chelsea Pier. And every part of the way, everybody was just like, let's do our part, where we can, like, where can we be the leader here? And eventually we did end up at Chelsea Pier. And the lines were so long. Oh gosh, but I'll tell you that, the neighbors in that area were amazing, because there were people coming down with trays of cups of water. Because it was hot. So, you know, it was very nice. And all things considered, considering the panic and considering like what a terrible, terrible situation we were in, everybody was very calm, and you had no idea we were hopping on a ferry. And the whole idea of the journey home was that we didn't know how we'd even get home. Like, we had never gone home from Chelsea Pier, and let alone from, I forget where we ended up, but, you know, so anyway, we did end up on a ferry, and then we had to kind of split up a little more, because now each of us were going to different parts of New Jersey. So we hopped on a shuttle, two of us hopped on a shuttle that was supposed to take us to Hoboken, where we were going to hop on a train to Newark. But that was a mess. But we did end up, I ended up getting on my train was not going to Newark. I had to go to like another stop and then go to Newark and then get home. And I do remember seeing a lot of people on, you know, covered in the dust. I was very fortunate not to have been in the mix of all that. And I attribute that to the people who I was with, who basically said, we're going to keep moving. In fact, even right when we got out of the building, the police officers were shouting, go north or go home. And so that's what we did. You know, we were doing what we were told, and we were of the mindset that we were just going to have to keep pushing through. Like, no matter how crappy things were, this was how we were surviving. I'm giving you the really shortened version, by the way. But so I'm finally on the train, trying to work out the details with my husband, because now I have no idea where, you know, where we're even going. I'm on my train, but and it was devastating sitting on that train, because went through every stop. And at this point, I have no idea how late it was, but surely it was late enough that these parking lots at the train stations should not have been full. And yet they were full of so many cars. And, you know, at every stop, they kind of instructed you to go out a certain exit. So finally they said my train was actually not going down to where I needed to go. So we got off in Long Branch, which was the last stop it was making. And I finally understood why they wanted you to go out a certain exit. It was because the hazmat teams were there to kind of like hose you down, to ask you questions. So I got to them and they said, you know, were you anywhere downtown? And I said, yeah, I was downtown. And they said, well, where were you? I said, well, I was in the World Trade Center. And they said, okay. You know, then they're like, they didn't even know what to do with me. They're like, okay, well, were you there when the buildings collapsed? And I said, no, I had already exited the area. And he said, well, okay, well, were you there in the building when it was hit? And I said, yeah, come with us. So they had me like, I had to step in some solution. And then I said, oh, you know, just so you know, because I had my briefcase with me. I said, these weren't the shoes I was wearing. I changed my shoes. Like I, somewhere along the way, had the foresight to bring my sneakers with me. So I had changed my shoes. They're like, okay, we'll dip those shoes in there too. And so I eventually got home, and you know, my husband said, I got to go get your train from the, or your car from the parking lot, because I had wasn't anywhere where my car was. Are you going to be okay? I said, yeah, I'll be okay. And I turned on the TV. Now, this is the first time in 12 hours that I have a clue what's going on. You know, I haven't seen any of this. I've been on the inside. And quite frankly, I still tell my ex-husband to this day, I would never have traded positions with him. Because had I seen what was going on the outside and he was on the inside, I think I would have had a nervous breakdown. I don't think I would have been able to handle it. So I started watching the news. Oh, and that's when I lost it, you know? And my father-in-law had called me. He had been in the army. So he's like, here's what you need to do. He pulls out the old Mr. Rogers quote, right? Look for the helpers. And I said, oh, you know, it's interesting. I said, when we were walking up to Chelsea Pier in like the last couple minutes, this whole parade of fire trucks from New Jersey were coming in. And they all had numbers, and everybody was cheering them on, like the biggest heroes you could ever come across. And you don't know what happened to them. But those are the kind of things that I try to remember, to know that, you know, there were definitely good people out there. When I left the experience, I had a lot of trouble sleeping. And a lot of nightmares. And, you know, it takes time. Like, Shelly, I was saying to you when we first connected here that sometimes I can tell this and I'm, you know, very cold about it. And sometimes I'm like this. I think anniversaries are very hard. the 20th is going to be particularly hard. Not just because they're anniversaries. And I'm so fortunate because I know so many people lost their lives that day. I know so many people lost their loved ones. I'm fortunate to be here. I'm fortunate that I didn't personally lose anyone. But it is a very heavy weight to bear. And it is, you know, when someone passes away, you personally get to experience that anniversary every year. When the whole world experiences a loss and you all mourn together, it's a lot. It's a lot to deal with. And there are times when I just, this is a terrible thing to say, but there are times when I really wish we could forget. Because it is heavy. But I do remember, and you know, you've been seeing this a lot in the last week, that New York was the nicest place after that. Like, we were like, because I did end up having to go back to the office, obviously. We had a temporary location. And one of the things that Morgan Stanley wanted to make sure, we had a memorial at St. Patrick's, but they also wanted to make sure that we got back into the city as quickly as possible so we could adjust and not be so scared that we didn't come back. So we had our temporary space. I did go back. And it was very nice. It was like, you know, everybody held doors for one another and, you know, you bumped somebody by accident. Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I'm so, are you okay? But going back to the city also brought a lot of hypervigilance, to the point that like a weird sound would really have me completely anxious, or, you know, anything out of the norm. The train stopped in the tunnel. I would send my husband a message that said, well, I don't think I'm coming home today. I think this is it, you know. Or one day I remember walking in and for some reason, all the storefronts were shuttered because we were working in our temporary office was around Times Square. So it was pretty busy no matter when you went. But there was one particular day that I went in and all the storefronts were shuttered. And that just seemed odd to me. And again, I was like, well, this is how we go. You know, something is going to happen. And that still to this day, I mean, we're talking nearly 20 years later. And to this day, there are some times where I'm like, yep, this is it. You know, and it's a terrible way to live. It's a terrible way to live. I mean, knowing it could always be the last day, right? But, you know, it's just, it's challenging and it's never gonna go away. And I always try to say 9/11 didn't define who I am, right? But it was a very defining moment. And really changed how I thought about a lot of things. I was very hateful for a while, which people who know me would tell you that's not at all the person I am. And I look back at that now and I'm disgusted by how hateful I was to people because I didn't trust people. So that's gotten better, thankfully. But that, you know, that basically is how it went down for me. And I know my experience wasn't nearly as bad as it was for so many other people who were able to get home that day and so many other people who lost their family members that day.
Do you see life differently now?
So the one thing I see a lot differently is that I am more appreciative of family, and balance. I will say this too. When I worked in the city, as much as I hated the commute, it was a long commute, even longer after we finally moved to our second temporary space, which was on over by the UN, you know, commuting 4 to 5 hours a day is not a good way to live. But I loved the World Trade Center, by the way. Like, I had so much pride. When I think about loss on 9/11, losing those buildings was a personal affront to me, because to me, I mean, you spent so much time there. It was my home. And I was so proud to say that that was where I worked. In fact, right before I got married, my sister and I took my grandfather there. My grandfather had never been to New York City before. And he was in awe. And we were so proud to, like, oh my God, we can share this with you. And, you know, it wasn't, you know, a year later that we no longer had that. So my point being, I am always very dedicated to work. I'm always, you know, a go-getter. But I know that I need to shut down now. You know, like, I know that work is not my life anymore. If I'm going to work, I'm going to enjoy it. So that's really where a lot of it has changed. I have two kids now, they're teenagers. And especially in this time of COVID, we're figuring it all out. But I do know that their needs have to come before work.
Is there anything else you want to add?
I have never been back to ground zero. I mean, I have had businesses downtown, but I will swiftly walk by the memorial. I won't go back. A lot of people feel like I need to go back there for closure. It's not closure for me. It would be reopening. And I do enough of that, you know, and I can memorialize or mourn in my own way. I don't really feel like I need to go there.